Endeavour Houston, we see a nominal MECO. Welcome to space.
First things first, reference frames. A reference frame can be thought of as an imaginary box which defines directions. They could be up, down, left, right, forward and backwards, or, for the more technically inclined among you, X, Y and Z. On the surface of the Earth, the reference frames we think in are pretty obvious. The sky is up, the ground is down. Forward, back, left and right are defined by whatever direction we're facing in. For satellites in orbit, things are a bit different. Let's say I just chuck a satellite up into space and I don't touch it and I don't let anything else touch it. Its orientation will stay fixed in space, regardless of what direction Earth's surface is in or the direction of travel for that satellite. This is an example of being in an inertial reference frame, where our imaginary direction box, our reference frame, has its orientation fixed relative to space and not relative to Earth. Now, the International Space Station is a bit different. It has a trick. It spins once every orbit. This way it can keep one side facing Earth and another side facing the direction of travel. So with the space station, we can think of things in a different reference frame, LVLH. That stands for local vertical, local horizontal. In other words, our reference frame imaginary box is defined relative to Earth's surface below us. If this were a perfect, easy world, we could just set the space station spinning at the right rate, and since it's in space, it would keep spinning forever and stay fixed in the LVLH reference frame, with no help from us. But as you've guessed, there's a bit more to it. Even though it's out in space, the space station still has a whole bunch of external factors pushing on it, and I mean that quite literally. First is the atmosphere. Even up at the 400km-ish altitude of the International Space Station, there's a teensy tiny amount of atmosphere lingering around, which provides a small amount of air resistance on the space station. This is why it needs to be periodically reboosted every few months, but it also messes with our perfect spinning. The amount of air resistance the space station experiences at any time largely depends on the orientation of its solar arrays. If we look from the perspective of the oncoming air, you can see that the surface area for us to push against is much larger as the solar panels are rotated into a more perpendicular orientation facing us. These solar panels are designed to rotate in order to track the sun throughout each orbit. This means that the amount of air resistance changes throughout each orbit and throughout each day. Since the center of air resistance and the center of mass aren't quite in the same position, this means that the air resistance causes some twisting or a torque to be applied to the ISS, and that affects our perfect spin rate that we need to stay in the LVLH reference frame. Now, onto complication number two, and that's the gravity gradient torque. The ISS is getting pulled on by Earth's gravity all the time, that's why it's in orbit, but not all parts of the space station get pulled on equally. Gravitational pull between objects gets weaker and weaker the further and further apart those two objects get from each other. So parts of the space station that are closer to Earth experience a teensy tiny amount more gravitational pull than the parts of the space station that are further away from Earth. And once again, that can mess with our perfect once-in-orbit spin. Those two things, gravity gradient torque and that air resistance torque, are the two main complications we have to contend with. The simple answer to them is that we try and balance them out by putting the space station in an orientation in the LVLH reference frame that means the air resistance torque and the gravity gradient torque oppose each other. This orientation is called torque equilibrium attitude, or TEA. These external torques being applied to the space station are changing all the time. So a torque equilibrium attitude is planned as an average over a whole orbit. The job of managing this falls to a controller in Houston called the ADCO, or Attitude Determination and Control Officer. TEAs aren't always used. Sometimes the space station needs to be rotated into a different orientation, such as during docking of supply vehicles like Soyuz. Generally, in these situations, the space station is oriented so that the docking port being used is facing along the orbital path of the approaching vehicle. This makes docking a much simpler task. So the International Space Station requires us to be able to actively control its attitude. This is done through the use of four Control Moment Gyroscopes, or CMGs, located in the Z1 truss and RCS thrusters located in the Russian segment. Before we dive into how control moment gyroscopes work, let's have a look at their younger brother, the reaction wheel. Reaction wheels work on the principle of conservation of angular momentum. You can see that if I use a motor to spin a wheel in the middle of a satellite, the satellite will spin in the opposite direction. The angular momentum of the wheel and the satellite are opposing each other and so add up to zero, just like they did before I started turning the motor. This is a pretty cool way of steering a satellite without using thrusters and hence without using fuel, but it does have a limitation referred to as saturation. To understand what saturation is, I'm simply going to show it to you. I'll take our satellite that's using its reaction wheel to spin. If we were to push on it from outside, just like air resistance or gravity gradient torque might do, I can slow it down. But if I were to switch off the reaction wheel now, the satellite would now start spinning in the opposite direction to which it had before. Now, if we want the satellite to stop spinning, we need to have the reaction wheel spinning all of the time. If once again I push the satellite from the outside, to stop the satellite spinning, the reaction wheel will have to go even faster. If I keep doing this, eventually the reaction wheel will be at its top speed and it won't be able to stop the satellite from spinning from these external pushes any longer. This is what saturation refers to. From here, control moment gyroscopes are pretty simple. They work on the exact same principle of conservation of angular momentum. The wheels in control moment gyroscopes spin at a constant speed. We'll represent their angular momentum with an arrow pointing through their axis of rotation. In their neutral position, they're all facing away from each other. This means that their angular momentum arrows all oppose each other, and so the control moment gyroscopes all add up to have a total angular momentum of zero. The CMGs can then rotate independently, so that their angular momentums add up as we desire them. Then, in order to conserve angular momentum, the whole ISS will have an opposing angular momentum, an opposing spin, just like we saw when we spun that reaction wheel on our satellite. It's all very similar to the reaction wheel, but instead of changing the speed of the reaction wheel, we're changing the orientation of the control moment gyros to get the desired angular momentum. And just the same as the reaction wheels, CMGs can be saturated. This will be when all of the angular momentum arrows of all four CMGs are pointed in the same direction, meaning they're at their maximum total angular momentum. In this situation, the CMGs need to be desaturated. This requires the use of reaction control system thrusters on the Russian segment to maintain the space station's orientation while the four CMGs return to their neutral position. The use of a torque equilibrium attitude is most advantageous because it allows the ISS to go for as long as possible without having to use thrusters to desaturate the CMGs, as thrusters require fuel and can also mess with delicate zero-g experiments. Generally, most desaturations take place when the ISS does large orientation changes, like when it's preparing for a docking or undocking. And that's how you steer the International Space Station. I sure hope you found this as interesting as I have, because it's pretty cool stuff. I'd really appreciate it if you considered supporting Simply Space on Patreon, and I'll catch you in the next video.